Today, our topic is minimally invasive outpatient spine fusion surgery. We are pleased to have Dr. William Tobler, a neurosurgeon with the Mayfield Clinic, chairman of the Christ Hospital Spine Surgery Center, and professor of neurosurgery at the University of Cincinnati. Thank you for being here, Dr. Tobler. You may now begin your presentation.
Thank you, Krista, and thank you for listening to our presentation on outpatient lumbar spine fusion surgery. We've developed techniques at the Mayfield Clinic and the Christ Hospital Spine Surgery Center for minimally invasive fusion surgery in the lumbar spine that can be formed as outpatient or same-day surgery, which sometimes allows patients to stay overnight. But it avoids a hospital stay. It results in shorter surgery time, less anesthesia, less tissue destruction, and less blood loss. The expertise that has been developed at the Spine Surgery Center since 2007 is unparalleled in a staff that cares for all of these patients before, during, and during immediate recovery after the surgery. This is an important component of the success that we have had with outpatient lumbar spine fusion. Spine fusion is the joining of two lumbar vertebrae by the placement of a cage or a spacer that is packed with bone graft material. We're not talking about other types of surgery in this presentation, such as discectomies or decompressions. We're talking specifically about lumbar spine fusion surgery in the outpatient setting. I'm going to speak to you about the techniques and about the different types of surgery that can be performed to treat these painful symptomatic conditions that have failed to respond to conservative care. Minimally invasive surgery is done with the intention of disrupting the normal tissues, muscles, and ligaments that support the spine by smaller incisions that are strategically placed, relying on the development of instrumentation and the use of intraoperative fluoroscopy that results in the ability to perform these procedures with less disruption of the supporting tissues of the spine. Traditional open spine surgery is illustrated across the top layer of illustrations. The muscles are stripped from the spine, retractors are placed holding the tissues open. The surgeon has direct visualization, as you see in the middle, of the elements of the spine that are being operated upon. This results in the placement of a large scar on the back of the spine that can be bothersome to some patients. The minimally invasive procedures have been developed to strategically place the smallest incision or opening possible over the area of interest. This is done with the simple concept of placing a series of dilators through the spine using X-ray guidance to the target area as defined on the left-hand side at the bottom. The surgery is performed through the small tube. It's usually less than 1 inch in diameter, and usually microscopic visualization or some other type of magnification is used. And the end result is a smaller incision that you see. It's popularized in certain magazines by the placement of a Band-Aid over the spine operation. So traditional open surgery is usually an incision in the back of the spine, in the midline, that results in longer time of exposure, more disruption of the native tissues, more blood loss, more exposure to possible infections, and longer hospital stays, and more lengthy recoveries. The traditional incision is illustrated in the right side at the bottom by the dotted black dashes and the minimal type of approach through the smaller green 1-inch incision for one level approach to the spine. The smaller incisions, less muscle distraction, disruption, direct exposure of the area of interest in the illustration below. You can see the successive dilation of the tubes being placed one over the top of the other, and then the retractor positioned at the side of the table over the area of interest defined by X-ray guidance. And then the surgery is performed through the tube as illustrated here. Illumination with a light source is obviously extremely important, and the surgical procedure begins. Very minimal blood loss associated with these procedures, which results in quicker recovery. I'm talking specifically about degenerative disc disease illustrated at the top. The disc, as you know, is a layer of cartilage and ligament that is between each of the vertebrae. The vertebrae in your spine are like a box, and they're boxes that are stacked one on top of the other. And the disc is a gasket. The disc has some elasticity associated with it. So when you twist and turn and bend, you're placing stresses on the disc. The disc begins to wear out and deteriorate. The disc collapses. The nerves, as you can see, are entrapped. And the goal of the spinal fusion is to restore the disc height, stop the motion, and then result in relief of pain from abnormal motion and removing pressure from the nerves. We rely heavily on intraoperative X-rays to localize the area of interest so that we can place our incision in the perfect location. As you see here, you see the two tubes that are placed in the spine. This is an approach from the back of the spine, and the illumination is very noticeable there on the bottom side, and all the surgery is performed through that. The cage that you see at the bottom is typically the term used for the spacer that is placed inside the disc to restore the disc height to stabilize the spine. The openings are typically packed with bone graft material that will then, over time, grow, and the vertebrae from above and below will fuse. We will often use what's called pedicle screws that are placed in the back of the spine to stabilize the spine in certain cases, but not in all cases. I just wanted to make a comment about lasers because we hear a lot of talk about laser spine surgery. The laser is a tool that is used for burning tissue. We've had extensive experience with the use of lasers in the treatment of brain tumors. Lasers can vaporize soft tissues. This is one type of a burning or cutting tool. We don't typically use lasers in our spine center, and we don't typically use lasers for minimally invasive spine surgery. The laser does not perform the surgical procedure itself, but it is heavily marketed in certain areas. I'm going to speak briefly about three of the types of degenerative disc disease or pathology that is treated with lumbar fusion. On the left, which I've already talked about, is degenerative disc disease where there is collapse or disintegration of the disc. People sometimes describe this as a bone-on-bone effect where the disc has completely desiccated or just basically gone away. The second type of pathology that we see is where the spine actually becomes dislocated. There is a slippage. The spine moves, the spine shifts, and sometimes this is extremely painful, and it moves from standing to sitting to bending. This is called spondylolisthesis. This is a very common pathology, and spinal fusion has some of the best outcomes associated with this particular type of pathology. On the right side, the last you see is a front view of the spine, and you see a curvature or a tilting of the spine. And this is called scoliosis or degenerative scoliosis. And the disc disintegrates maybe only on one side and the spine begins to tilt. In certain circumstances, spinal fusion is used for this purpose. This illustration shows in one picture the different approaches that are available to surgeons to fuse the spine. And there is an alphabet list of terms that are commonly seen: ALIF, DLIF, TLIF, PLIF, and AxiaLIF. And you can see those spelled out in the illustration. But this illustration shows a patient standing. The front or the belly is on the left, and the back of the spine is on the right side of the illustration. And we're looking directly at the side of the spine. The anterior approach, the ALIF, is where we make an incision through the abdomen and approach the spine from the front. The spine can be approached from the direct lateral approach, or from the side, or from the flank, or from where the general location of the kidney is. And there are certain reasons to use that approach, certain reasons to use the anterior or ALIF approach. And then lastly, the TLIF or posterior approach is where the spine is fused by coming in from the back or just off the back to the side. And one more approach is the AxiaLIF, which is an approach to the bottom of the spine through the tip of the tailbone. I'm going to spend a little bit more time talking about each one of these individual approaches. So the ALIF approach through the abdomen is done as seen here. Incision is marked out in the front of the abdomen, usually around the umbilicus or the belly button, as we call it. And that approach does require opening the muscle. The cross-sectional illustration on the right side shows the surgeon inserting the hand into the abdomen to sweep away the abdominal contents and to expose the spine directly. So this is a commonly performed spinal fusion approach, the anterior approach. This illustration shows the incision and shows the spine underneath the skin. So the goal is to remove the disc there that you see, the lowest disc at L5-S1, or the upper discs can be removed as needed, but this is a very common approach. This incision here is made crosswise, but it can also be made in a vertical fashion or up and down. The spine is exposed, and then a series of instruments are used to cut into the defective disc. This is a very sharp knife or a scalpel, and a series of instruments are used to gradually resect the entire disc. Once the disc has been removed, the cage or the spacer, as you see, is inserted and it restores the height of the disc. The center is packed with bone graft material, and then a fixation plate or screws can be placed into that spacer, or posteriorly, pedicle screws can be placed. And this X-ray example shows an ALIF. It shows the cage. The cage is slightly angled, it has a curvature to it, and then the pedicle screws fixated in the back. And this is typically called a 360 fusion, but this is a minimally invasive approach. The next approach is the lateral approach, called the DLIF or the XLIF. This is an incision that's made in the direct lateral side of the spine, and the one problem with this approach is that the lowest disc, the L5-S1, is not appropriate for this technology because the hip bone, really it's called the pelvic bone or the iliac crest, it's the bone that you feel around your belt on the side of your spine that prevents us accessing as surgeons the L5-S1 space. So this is a very ideal procedure for the upper or mid portions of the spine. And this example here shows the front view. The green cone shows the approach of how we enter the spine and avoid opening the abdomen. We avoid opening the back. It is not possible to do this at the lower end of the spine, as I had indicated. And there are some structures that are possibly in the way. Someone who's had a kidney surgery or removal of a kidney might not be a good candidate because there might be too much scar tissue in the back, so that might not be a good option. The illustration on the left shows a big open incision. At the bottom, it shows the incision in the side that is typically made for the lateral or the XLIF type approach. The illustration on the right shows the retractor or the tubular retractor that's in place through which the surgeon performs the XLIF or the lateral interbody fusion. The big muscle mass that you see there is what's called the psoas muscle. That's a very important muscle that supports the spine and attaches to the hip bone and is important for spinal stability. From the lateral approach, we have to open that muscle. So that's a very important step that is done very carefully in order to preserve the function of the psoas muscle. There are nerves that come out of the spine and particularly down toward the low end of the spine, the femoral nerve, which is a very important nerve for operating the leg, is at some risk of being irritated or even injured during this procedure. So the surgeon monitors the function of these nerves in order to maintain protection. The big vessels, the iliac vein and the aorta, are on the front of the spine. They're in the area of the surgery, but not usually an issue, though there is a potential for injury to those vessels. The hip bone or the pelvic bone, as you can see in this illustration, is visualized and may make it difficult to gain access to the fourth and fifth vertebrae here, where you see the spondylolisthesis or the slippage. But in most cases, the L4-5 level is accessible with the lateral approach, but not with the L5-S1. Being the problem for this surgery. This is an illustration of the cylindrical retractor. This operation can be done at multiple levels, but typically one level for outpatient lumbar fusion. This can be done with almost no blood loss. Patients can take minimal pain medication. The surgery can be completed usually in about an hour, and this results in a faster return to normal activities. This video illustrates the patient lying on his side with the incision being made in the flank and shows the insertion of the dilators. The screen on the right side is just a picture of the monitor that is typically used to help the surgeon monitor the function of the nerves during this procedure. The dilators are placed, the retractor is placed over the dilator, and then the disc is removed through this long tube, and this tube can open and provide all the space that the surgeon needs to complete the procedure. Again, like the ALIF, removing the entire disc and then placing the spacer, the cage, packed with bone graft material to restore the disc height and alignment, as you see here on this illustration. Here is an example of a patient who has a collapsed degenerative disc with a spondylolisthesis. You can see where the disc is collapsed and it's almost bone on bone, and where the bone of L2 has shifted forward to the vertebrae of L3. This is a great example of interbody fusion that could be performed with the direct lateral approach. This postoperative X-ray shows the spacer in position, both on the front view seen on the left, Those little black markers are in the cage itself, so the surgeon can recognize the position of the cage. And you could actually see the shadows, the dark shadows of the bone graft material inside the spacer. And you can see on the side view on the right where the disc space has been restored and where the alignment of the spine, where the spine is back in more normal alignment with this procedure, has been accomplished. This illustration shows the minimally invasive technique that we use. It's one of many different companies that manufacture this equipment that allows us to place these pedicle screws through minimally invasive or very tiny procedures to support the spine when needed from the back. This is the same patient now with pedicle screws in place. We have completed the surgery, and this has resulted in realignment of the spine, locking it down in a stable position, placing the cage, and having a really great outcome for this patient. The next approach is the TLIF approach. This is a very common approach, transforaminal approach, which means that we approach the spine through the back just off to the side by coming through the opening where the nerves pass out of the spine. You can see at each level, at L1, L2, and L3, there is a nerve that exits the spine. That's the foramen. So this approach accesses the spine by going through the foramen. Each one of those nerves has a very specific function that goes into the leg or down to the lower extremity. It provides sensation and motor function. These nerves are potentially in the way of the surgical procedure. There is some risk of damage to those nerves, but the surgery itself is usually done to restore damage that's occurred to those nerves from collapse and compression from the degenerative disc. A series of dilators are placed right over the foramen and the facet, which is the bone that surrounds the back of the foramen, and the surgeon completes the procedure through the tube. The facet bone is removed, the nerves are protected, the remainder of the disc is removed, and then the bone graft, or the cage as you see here, is advanced into the disc space to complete the interbody fusion through the TLIF approach. This is an example of a patient who has a spondylolisthesis at the L4-5 level. You can see the collapse and forward slip at L4-5 on the x-ray on the left, and you can see more detail on the MRI illustration on the right side. What we do in this procedure is we remove the remainder of the disc, advance the spacer, place the screws, and then with a significant amount of force on these instruments, we realign and pull the spine back into its normal alignment. We lock the screws down, and on the right side, you see the restoration of disc height, alignment, and fixation. This is a very commonly performed procedure for a common condition and commonly with excellent results in the outpatient setting. The procedure is, again, this illustration, it's performed by the surgeon working through these tubes, sometimes only placing the tube on one side, as seen on the left, and sometimes by placing the tubes on both sides, depending on the particular case. This x-ray shows excellent restoration of disc height, placement of the cage in the disc space, and you can see the markers on the cage, and the spine has been perfectly realigned and locked into position with the pedicle screws. Rehabilitation with these patients begins very quickly after surgery, within 2 to 4 weeks. Most of these patients never wear a brace after surgery. The rapid rehabilitation, reduction of narcotic use allows patients to return to work on a very rapid basis, sometimes within 4 to 6 weeks to doing physical labor. The last approach is the AxiaLIF approach, which is the axial inner body fusion approach. Now this approach makes an incision, with this approach an incision is made at the tip of the tailbone and a series of tubes are passed through the front of the sacrum into the L5-S1 level of the spine. As illustrated here, the pathway of approach goes very close to the rectum. So patients take a bowel preparation prior to the surgery, much like you do for a colonoscopy. This operation offers some unique advantages over other fusion surgeries. No muscles or ligaments are cut whatsoever with this procedure. The access to the L5-S1 through the tip of the sacrum is very easy. It's performed with radiographic guidance, and it is an advantageous procedure for patients who are obese. It can be used for patients who've had a prior spinal fusion from one of the other approaches that did not heal properly. And it is supported sometimes with patients having facet screws or pedicle screws placed from behind. Patients who've had surgery or radiation treatments in this area are not candidates for this procedure. And some patients have a sacral curvature that you see on the right side that is not appropriate, does not provide the proper trajectory for us to place the vertical rod that you see in the middle. So this evaluation has to be completed prior to making plans to do this surgical procedure. This is an example of a patient with a spondylolisthesis at L5-S1, an ideal candidate for this approach. You can see on the front view, the incision is 1 inch in length, made at the tip of the tailbone, and then the tube over dilators is placed to the sacral bone where a channel is drilled through the bone, and that tube is only about 2/3 of an inch in diameter. A series of instruments is passed through the tube to cut out and remove what remains of the disc. And then once that's prepared, the bone graft material is advanced into the disc space. A measurement is taken, a rod is chosen, and the AxiaLIF rod is advanced through that tube, which is removed, and the fusion through the spine has been completed. And sometimes posterior support with smaller fixation devices called facet screws, illustrated here, have the advantage of being much smaller than pedicle screws, but in certain circumstances, pedicle screws are used rather than facet screws. That depends on the conditions of the patient, the preferences of the surgeon, and the needs of the particular operation. This is the postoperative CAT scan image showing this patient with the AxiaLIF rod in place. The AxiaLIF rod is the very white vertical rod that you see. The white material in the disc space is the bone graft material, and you can see this patient had pedicle screws on the very far left illustration and on the very far right illustration. In summary, with all of these procedures, our postoperative rehabilitation program offers great benefits because the patients can resume their activities sooner. They will maintain the strength and function of their musculature. Their musculature has been less traumatized and damaged by the surgery. So patients can begin their reconditioning program. They can begin mobilization, hopefully preventing scar tissue formation and return to normal work activities and functions and take less narcotic medications. Final thoughts with regard to minimally invasive outpatient lumbar spine fusion. quicker recovery, high patient satisfaction. We encourage patients to become spine athletes to maintain for their lifetime their conditioning program for their spine, which has been treated surgically. And lastly, all spine surgeons are not alike. Ask about the training, the experience, the background, and the methodologies that your surgeon is going to employ. Talk to them about the possibility of outpatient spine fusion. Not all patients will qualify for outpatient spine surgery, mostly in some circumstances because of medical conditions that simply will require hospitalization. Multiple levels are generally not performed in the outpatient setting. Some patients will require 3, 4, or more levels of spinal fusion for their conditions, which will not qualify for the outpatient experience. We're very proud of our experience since 2007 in the outpatient setting. We continue to treat more patients with better results and better outcomes. Thank you.